So in this video, we're going to be thinking about one of the most important biological molecules, which is ATP. So ATP stands for adenosine triphosphate. And it's an energy carrier molecule that powers loads and loads of different biological processes. So we're going to have a little bit of a look at its structure and then think about how it can be used to power biological reactions. So the structure of ATP ATP is actually one of the nucleotides. So the A in DNA is ATP, but let's have a look at the structure of the nucleotide. So it's a nucleotide. So at the middle, it has a ribose sugar. Then on one side of the molecule, it has a nucleotide base. So it has the base adenine. Some double bonds in there as well. But you don't need to worry too much about. So that's the so that's the base. So in DNA, we'd be interested in what's going on at that end of the molecule in terms of base pairing. But when ATP is being used as an energy carrier, we're more interested in this end of the molecule where we have three phosphate groups. So just drawing those all out there. So that triphosphate is three phosphate groups. And you'll notice with a phosphate group, when it's dissolved in water, so in the cytosol, then we've got actually four negatively charged oxygens on those three phosphate groups. So that's a really high density of negative charge, which means that a lot of chemical potential energy in there. Negative charge things don't usually like being next to each other. They want to split apart and repel. So although this is a perfectly stable molecule, there's a lot of chemical potential energy stored in that molecule, which means that if we break that molecule and let those oxygens go off in different directions, then we're going to release some of that energy. So what we can do is if we break that bond there, we will release energy. And we release quite a lot of energy. We release 30 kilojoules per mole of ATP. That's quite a lot of energy, biologically speaking. And we can use that energy to do useful work. Okay, so because we've got all of these negative oxygens, we've got lots of chemical potential energy. If we break the bond, we can release that. So I'm just going to summarise that up here as a reaction cycle. So to hydrolyze, so we start with ATP. To break this phosphate bond here, we do need some water. When we do that, we create ADP, so that's diphosphate, two phosphates, plus a free phosphate group, which I summarise as P with a circle, is a phosphate group. So if we go from ATP and water to ADP plus phosphate, we've broken this bond here, we release the energy. And because that reaction releases energy, we think we can call it a thermodynamically favourable reaction. So in terms of the sort of energy of the cell, this reaction wants to happen. If it's given the opportunity to happen, then it will do so. That doesn't mean that ATP is unstable. ATP is a stable molecule, but if the reaction is able to happen, so we've got the right environment for it, then that energy, because it releases energy, will be thermodynamically favourable. Of course, that means that going in the other direction, so if we wanted to make some more ATP from ADP plus free phosphate, that reaction would require energy. So that would be an unfavourable reaction. So in terms of how we express this mathematically, you'll notice that here I had minus 30 kilojoules per mole. So releasing energy gives us minus kilojoules per mole. It's the way it expressed. And if you need energy for a reaction, we express it as plus kilojoules per mole. So we have this nice little reaction cycle. So ATP plus water. If you hydrolyze that bond, you release a phosphate, you also release energy, and that is thermodynamically favourable. And that energy that we've been released can use to be power other biological reactions or processes. So we can power other biological processes using the energy released from ATP. Because it releases quite a lot of energy, we can use that to do biological work. So the classic example of this is the first reaction in respiration. So respiration is taking glucose and oxidizing it to ultimately release energy that we can use in cellular reactions. So the first reaction in respiration is this. So what we need to do is to go from glucose to glucose 6 phosphate. So a phosphate group needs to be added to the glucose is the first reaction. So we need a phosphate group in order to do that. So that's the very first thing that happens in respiration. But unfortunately, that is an unfavourable reaction. It requires 19 kilojoules per mole of energy. So that is unfavourable. So that means that that reaction biologically won't happen. It doesn't want to happen. It's not favourable for the cell to do it. So that's our first reaction. But we know we've got our second reaction of ATP plus water can go to ADP plus phosphate. And we know that that releases energy, so 30 kilojoules. And that is favourable. So this second reaction, the ATP reaction, has released 30 kilojoules per mole. We need 19 kilojoules in order for the first reaction to happen. So there's more energy released than we need to make this molecule to make the first reaction happen. So we can therefore have a coupled reaction where we combine the two. So we can say we have glucose plus ATP goes to glucose 6 phosphate plus ADP. And that, if we do the maths on that, that leaves us still with 11 kilojoules per mole of energy. So that's still favourable. So we've used the energy released by this ATP hydrolysis reaction in order to power this glucose and phosphate reaction. And you'll notice that we've actually used the phosphate from ATP and stuck it on the glucose. So just to draw that out. So glucose has the structure like this. So it's a six-ring sugar. So those are hydroxyl groups. And then there's a carbon, two hydrogens and an oxygen up there. And We can number these carbons. So we always number the carbons starting here. So that's carbon 1, carbon 2, 3, 4, 5 is there. And this is carbon 6. Okay, so carbon 6 is sticking up. So you can have that plus ATP goes to, so most of the sugar is unchanged. So we've got the same structure, same hexagonal structure. Then up on our carbon 6, so this is why it's called glucose 6 phosphate. So we've now got CH2, and instead of that hydroxyl group, we've added a phosphate to the molecule. So that is carbon 6. So that's why it's called glucose 6 phosphate. We've added a phosphate group to carbon 6, plus we've got our ADP. So the phosphate from ATP is 3 times phosphates. That's 2 times phosphates plus, there's the third phosphate up there. So we've actually taken the phosphate away from ATP. We leave ourselves with ADP, which has 2 phosphates, and that third phosphate is now on the sugar. So, but it's all to do with these energy levels. So the ATP, because it's got this high energy bond, it's released the energy. We're using that energy to power something unfavourable. And in this case, that's a reaction involving glucose. So without this, without the ability to couple, that reaction just wouldn't be able to happen. And just one last thing, this isn't happening spontaneously in the cell. This is catalysed by an enzyme, and the enzyme is called hexokinase is the enzyme. So hexo means 6, so it's using a 6 carbon sugar. Kinase equals an enzyme that adds phosphates onto things. So this is an enzyme that adds a phosphate onto something with 6 carbons. So the enzyme is called hexokinase. And that's the first reaction to happen in respiration. So it's all forms around this molecule, and the fact that we can couple these reactions together, we can use something favourable to power something unfavourable. And there's lots of examples like that, and some of my other videos will explain that, but almost everywhere you look in biology, you've got these sorts of coupling reactions happening.